Jose Arroyo, Emmy Award-winning comedy writer. Besides being a brilliant comedy writer, you're one of the few people who has actually gotten his cartoons published in The New Yorker.
Yes, from time to time. Yes.
But that's like that is like an amazing accomplishment for.
It's something I love to do. I love to draw, and I've always loved to draw. And I worked very hard to get funny. It takes time, and so I combine them both. I think my drawing skills are about 15 years behind my joke writing skills, but luckily in The New Yorker, and this is rightly, I think they're correct to do this, they favor, you know, they prefer a good punchline over a clean, perfect cartoon drawing style, you know?
Right.
James Thurber.
You're there. I mean, your stuff, I hope you brought some potato chips with you that we can.
I did bring some potato chips. I brought some potato chips, in a classic overcorrection. I brought quite a few.
They all like potato chips. He'll start showing these cartoons, and I could just shut down the rest of the show and just have him show us these cartoons. And what's especially enjoyable for me is they were all rejected.
They're all rejected. The ones they said nope. And they sent them back. So what we're getting
is perfect for me.
A cavalcade of failure. You've built an empire on failure. This is perfect.
It's perfect for me because I get to enjoy the cartoon. Then yes. I get to enjoy that it was rejected. So I'm not
exactly
threatened. I'm not threatened by your success. I get to enjoy your pain.
Well, there's a writer, a cartoonist named Matt Diffie, who actually publishes a book called The Rejection Collection. And it is a collection of New Yorker cartoons that were rejected mostly for being utterly tasteless, some scatological and so on. And he's got a second book of that coming out very soon. So look for The Rejection Collection. I am not featured. I was rejected from... How does that make you feel? Great.
I listen.
Okay.
I'm dead inside. I like to be. I'd rather be protective of you than looking up to you. That's my.
I understand. Exactly. It's better to be condescendingly comforting than it is to be admiring someone. I totally believe that. It's like
we worked on the Dennis Miller show together during back when the Dennis Miller show was at, respected.
I would say he was at the time an equal opportunity offender.
Right.
That's the way I've always phrased it.
And I had seniority over you.
You did. Yes.
But I realized you were better than I was. So I used to go into your office and I say, let me give you advice. Do you mind if I just give you some paternalistic advice?
And then you have this way of talking that is extended and slow and portentous. And so it sounds important and real. And then you hear what you say. And then it's like, oh, wait, okay.
I would literally go into his office. I had a bad night with the family. I'm not feeling funny. Let me just give you advice. And then you thank me for it. And I would put my feet up on his table. On your desk and give you nonsensical advice.
You gave me stock tips. You said, give me your money. I'll invest it for you, Jose.
I did give you good stock advice. You
did. I guess, you gave me lots of good stock tips. I should have believed you.
What did I tell you? What did I tell you?
Everything on Zune. Do everything on the portable digital device that Microsoft is coming out with. It's going to change the world.
What did I do? No, seriously, what did I tell you?
Again, we're looking at 20 years ago.
You're the only person who thanked me.
You're assuming I paid attention.
You're the only person who ever called me up and thanked me.
Oh my gosh. Well, I can't. Was it index funds?
Yes.
Yes. Absolutely true. Yes. And that was actually backed up by the John Bogle book. The guy who created Vanguard said, don't gamble on any individual stocks, put it in an index fund. It goes up and down and so on. And you've said that many, many times. I'll give you that one.
This was like 25 years ago. I would come into your office, not feeling funny, insecure. I was the senior employee.
You were the senior employee. And yes.
And I needed to feel I could dominate you. So I gave you financial advice.
You gave me exactly. I would be writing in my office and I'd hear the door handle. And then you and Leah Krinsky would just peek in and just stare at me and then close it. These were alpha moves of intimidation. And I'm still, where's Dr. Hershen?
There were no laws in that writing room. This was
a lawless writing room. But it was actually, I thought the horrible discourse was at a high level. Is that possible? Right. Like some of the jokes were terrible, but very high quality terrible. Right. So,
right. Anyway, I have very happy memories of. So let's look at your failure.
My failure. Okay. Failure. You know, it's funny. I wrote a song about you. Have you heard the song I wrote about your show?
No.
Okay. I wrote a song and I thought, and I actually sent you a copy, but you never played it or heard it because, and I think it's because you're afraid of being brought down low.
Yes. I'm the alpha. In this relationship, I have to be.
You have to be the alpha.
The alpha.
Right. Well, when you get the confidence to hear me sing a song about your show, I'm ready. Okay. In the meantime, let's go to the comments.
My personality. I can dish it out, but I.
Yes, exactly. Like the classic bully.
Yes.
Who, when confronted, gets freaks right. out and overcome. Yeah, exactly. Right. Exactly.
And if you know something I don't know, that I feel less than. So let's enjoy your failure, please.
All right. Here's my failure.
This is Jose Arroyo.
Okay.
AA.
The following. Drawings were rejected by the august and historic New York.
Now describe the picture because we're on a podcast.
So what we're looking at now is it was Mother's Day recently. So this is a one that I actually posted on Instagram. It's it was related to Mother's Day. It's two Vikings in a long ship. They're heading toward an unsuspecting village. They're rowing toward it. And one Viking is turning to the other and saying, "What are you pillaging for mom?" Is that one?
Hang on. To do the reveal for our virtual studio audience here in Zoom.
Yes.
Why don't you start like just lift it up
like this, and then
bring it up like this, so that by the time you're done describing it, we can see the caption. So start.
Oh, I see. Okay. So bring it up like this, and
yeah.
Then...
So start. Hang on for 1 second. So lower the whole thing. Lower it, and now start bringing it up.
Okay.
And as you're describing it, then
I see.
That will be a good reveal.
Sounds good. All right. Let's.
I love alpha dogging you. That was good. I loved alpha dogging. Thank you.
That was a classic example of that. Yes. Okay.
More so failure. Failure. More failure.
These are two slugs, garden slugs. They're just sad and they're ugly and they're looking at each other. And one says, "I looked it up. We're not considered a delicacy anywhere." Okay. You don't have to laugh.
I love that. "I looked it up. We're not considered a delicacy anywhere." You would think the French would.
Your words, not mine. Yes. But somebody would have batter fried these by now.
Right.
I couldn't find anybody who eats slugs. If your audience can correct me, that's the one behind that.
Well, a couple of Russian soldiers in Ukraine are eating some slugs.
Oh, there we go. Now it's political.
Caliber slugs. USA. USA. More Jose failure. This is great. I love these are all failures.
The New Yorker looked at them, turned up its snooty nose and said, "Pass."
This is Jose's pain. Let's enjoy Jose's pain. Go ahead.
So here's two goldfish. This was an easy one to draw because I was in a hurry and I was trying to get that quota, you know, a limit, a number. So I decided, oh, quick, two goldfish talking. One is upset, the other's behind, and it's saying it's been 12 seconds and you're still angry. Again, take.
That's brilliant. I mean, short term, but they don't have memories.
Exactly, they have no memories. Exactly.
How could you not? You're a failure. How could they not love that?
I agree. I'm a complete.
How could they not get that?
This is a travesty. I don't know. Maybe here's my suspicion: is that maybe someone else had one that was similar, or they're like, oh no, because you know, two people may have the same idea. Maybe they.
It's offensive to readers with short-term memory loss.
But they would forget it.
You're exactly right.
Exactly. So
maybe they have a goldfish who can't remember anything past 3 seconds and they're offended. This is so much fun enjoying your failure. Right. Please continue.
If you'd like that. All right, here's a horrible machine that's destroying buildings, and two scientists are running for their lives. And the caption is, we got so caught up in, can we make an unstoppable killing machine? We never asked, should we make us an unstoppable killing machine?
Wait a second.
Unstoppable killing machine.
Wait a second.
Why would you even make them?
Wait a second. How could they reject that?
Again, full disclosure.
How could they reject that?
There's a brilliant cartoonist named Paul Noth. And I, in the back of my head, the little marble was going, did Paul Noth do something about we got so caught up that we forgot this thing? And I don't know if it was unstoppable killing machine, but he may have used that comedy sort of phrasing. We got so caught up, we never thought of doing this, which I think comes from like, you know, Jurassic Park or something.
Right.
That maybe it was too similar to that. So
this is the guy, Mr. Big from City.
That's Chris Noth. That's Chris Noth. Paul Noth is a cartoonist. It's very, very funny.
Okay, let's enjoy your pain. This makes me so happy because these are really funny, and he's in pain.
All right. Would you like to try to caption one of the drawings that I made and see what your caption is?
No.
Okay.
No, I just want to enjoy your failure, your rejection.
There's plenty.
I don't want to reveal how unfunny I am. Go ahead.
All right. Well, here's a cutesy one. It's three. It's coyotes looking up at the moon. And one is got his mouth talking. And he's just saying, let's take it from Awu.
I am so happy they rejected that.
I thought it was justice. I thought it was silly and
this explains this. Hang on for 1 second. This explains so much. There's no justice in the world.
Isn't that what got us into comedy? Like, didn't you told me years ago on Dennis Miller's show that we get paid something like we get paid for the amount of stuff they reject from us, because you would write a ton of stuff for Dennis for a specific show. And wouldn't you say 80% was thrown
all
out?
All of it was rejected. All of it.
All but two or three lines, right. One or two paragraphs in the rant, a couple of photos.
Yeah.
This is why, you know, there are giant writing staffs so that everybody can pick up the slack, but nobody gets, you know, all of the stuff in. In fact, it was a legend that Leah Krinsky once wrote almost the entire Dennis Miller rant, but it was an outlier in how brilliant she was in that particular one. And it's usually a team effort and always a lot of stuff on the cutting room floor.
Right. I don't write for the show. I write for the rejection. I write to go home and go.
Well, yeah, I hope so. Well, you better. Your record. Oh my gosh.
All right. More rejection, more failure.
More failure. Okay. So you go by these cliches. Of course, there's the guy who climbs to the top of the mountain to talk to a guru. And I thought this one actually might work either for the New Yorker or for the Wall Street Journal, but it is a man addressing a guru. He's just climbed up and you can see, and the guru is saying, you're going to hate me, but the answer is more money.
You know what? You should send that to Dennis. I'm serious.
I hope he's doing well.
He did a trip, I think, to Nepal, and his wife made him climb. He of all people did that journey. Amazing. And spoke to some guy in a. He sought enlightenment.
Oh my gosh!
You should send him that.
I would be happy to. I'd be happy to. This one, I think. Maybe a lot of women in your audience would enjoy. It's a woman looking through a microscope and she's saying, "You lied about your height."
I like that. I'll tell you why I love that. It's imprecise. there are many, you're so smart, you save that for last, because this is one we can talk about.
That's the one we can talk about.
Now, you have more? Do you have more?
You say it's imprecise. Well, I don't think anything's going to top that one. So.
No. I want more.
You want the residue. You want the part of the coffee at the bottom where it's all muddy, right? You want the really rejected one.
Let's keep going. I would want, but go ahead.
I thought it was pretty good, but again, other people didn't. These are more conceptual. This is two devils. One's about to poke a human into a lake of fire, and he's kind of looking happy, and he goes, "It beats the banality of good."
Wow.
You have to know that Hannah Arendt philosophy, the banality of evil.
You should send that to Mark Breslin, would love that. That is so brilliant. Well, you have to know the banality of evil. But
yes, exactly.
But have you tried sending that to the New Yorker they should love that.
It's again, the cartoons they pick.
You are so great at this. You really are. And what, again, the fact that this stuff has been rejected, it just reminds me that the universe.
David, it's the way of the world.
Injustice. The universe bends towards injustice.
I would say any writer or any comedian or any person listening to this, please know that it's a numbers game, that you have to write, 90, and then maybe they accept one or two. It's just the way it is.
Don't get me started on waste. There's so much waste in our society that you have people at the top who are paid not just to, spew carbon into the air and waste, but they waste people's ideas. There's so much stuff that just gets wasted. And there's certain people who delight in wasting other people's time and talent. More. This stuff is, in all seriousness, this stuff should not be rejected. I'm happy it was rejected.
I'm happy with them. I'm not rejecting. I'm proud of your effort to draw them to stone.
You're a loser. Come on. No, I mean, there. It's you should be very angry and, filled with.
What good would it do?
It would make me happy to see you angry and depressed. I love this. This is great. And do you have any more? Because they're potato chips.
They're potato. One, the last one. The last one is just people in a huge amphitheater, and they're all looking back at a megaphone. They're in a stadium, and the stadium and the megaphone is blaring something. They're all looking back at it, and the stadium megaphone is saying, "Statistically speaking, two of you are murderers." Again, we're just the numbers game, but
wow, the numbers game.
Yes, yes. I agree, by the way, that what we could say is a lot of quality is set aside, but for other quality, and that's where somebody's judgment comes into play. They're both funny, but I prefer this one. You know, it's almost like deciding colors or songs or something. Well, which, how do you rank things that, you know, there are millions of really good ones. Why is this one necessarily better than another one? So anyway, I you have to sort
now
of.
How long does it take you to churn out that many? Or do you do a cartoon?
That compilation there was over months. I took out a bunch of the ones that weren't topical or would resonate maybe with your listeners a little more. It takes me a long time, a very, very slow drawer. The fact that it took me years to do that comic book that in L.A.
Where is it?
Here
it is. This is Treating the Oedipal Complex by Jose Arroyo. It's a brilliantly fun cartoon. It's a little late for Mother's Day. But where is your book? I have it somewhere.
It's fine. Yeah.
What is the name of your book? One Day in L.A. Right?
Somewhere in L.A.
Somewhere in L.A. And you left the shot. Oh, there you are. Somewhere in L.A.
A book of hours.
A day in the life of Los Angeles.
A day in the life of the Los Angeles. So day is something like 3:29 in the morning. I think we've talked about this one already. Somewhere in L.A. A waitress inches out of the bed of one of the stars of the Expendables. just sneaking out. Now back again, before pandemic, the Expendables, which was a franchise with Sylvester Stallone and a lot of aging action stars, they were gonna make a third one. And so I thought, oh, let me get ahead of this. I know this movie's coming out. And of course it never did. So that one feels a little
because of COVID.
Because of COVID, exactly.
You really picked a little price. When I think of all the people who have suffered from COVID.
All right, I'm not saying that I...
No, it's unfair.
No, you're right.
It's unfair that COVID did this. I was
not comparing my suffering to anyone else's.
I think we're coming up on 1 million who died from COVID. Yes. Yeah, 1 million and one. I will say it's 1 million and 1.
With that... you put me in my place. Thank you.
Let's plug your book.
This is still available on another billionaire site. I stopped tweeting after Elon Musk bought Twitter, but I think I don't have the courage of my convictions to leave Twitter. But I'm confessing to your viewer, to your listeners, that I'm just dragging my feet about posting on there because I just think Instagram is another billionaire. Twitter is this billionaire. This is available on Amazon, another billionaire. It's like, I feel like, do I have to give money to a billionaire? Is that required now to have some kind of social life? Or
we have the Reverend Barry W. Lynn coming up.
Oh,
maybe he can give you special dispensation. Let me see. Reverend Barry W. Lynn. Do you know the Reverend?
I heard him in the past, yes.
Yes. He's...
I'm unmuting. What can I do for you?
Reverend Lynn, I was just wondering if there's a way around staying sort of in the public light and not having to fund one of 3 or 4 millionaires, whether it's an Apple or Amazon or Twitter or Facebook. Can we avoid billionaires and still engage in our society?
You could rob their homes. I mean, I wouldn't recommend it, but it's one of the things that could happen.